afternoon, everyone. Forgive me for my level of speaking, so if I'm not that clear because my throat is not helping me, just please stop me and ask me to go back to what I'm saying. I will try today to give you a quick glimpse on the Italian way in which we have dealt with gentrification, and we are dealing still with gentrification nowadays, and also trying to combine the literatures and the evidence on gentrification and tourism, and especially, as you already discussed that in the morning, platform economy and the short-term rental economy as well. So we'll try to do this in a full hour to do that.
Yeah.
So I will try to. just readily, there has been a debate, and it's still ongoing, a debate in Italy, whether we do have gentrification in our country. And this may sound weird from people coming from outside Italy, which might have thought, oh yes, of course, you do have gentrification because it's an urban issue, and so when you have cities, then you have gentrification. But still, we kind of discussed that in Italy. Many colleagues are not very convinced about it. Those who are pro, so who think that we have to adopt this literature towards our cities are saying, of course, we are dealing with a similar phenomenon worldwide, even though it appears with different timings, which is fairly true. As you might know, the issue of gentrification was discovered, labeled at the end of the 50s in UK, in London, by Roof Glass. And of course, in Italy at the end of the 50s, our problem wasn't gentrification. So, of course, there are different timings, and the way in which we discover the issue happened decades afterwards. Then, also another phenomenon, the issue of magnitude. Of course, we hardly can compare what happened in New York City or in London with what has happened or is happening nowadays, even in Milan. Because the magnitude of the phenomenon is different, regulation are different, the city economy is different, the size of the city is different, the density of the city is different, so the magnitude of gentrification actually is absolutely different. And of course, one other key element that makes some huge difference is the issue of the political conditions. So again, the way in which the state and the different layers and levels of the state have been constructed in the past centuries have an impact. It's a path of dependence, which you still see ongoing nowadays in cities, in regions, in metropolitan areas, and also at the national scale. So all these conditions are different and give some specific shape to what actually gentrification is. But there's also people who say you cannot adopt this literature because Italy is somehow exceptional in terms of cultural, city culture, the legacy of the Italian Renaissance city, then Baroque cities, then 19th century cities, then 20th century cities, the way in which the industrial city impacted differently across Italian historical core, urban core, which again, if you see it from the point of view of Torino, doesn't make that sense because it's very industrial, it's very Detroit-like or Chicago-like city. But if you see this from the point of view of Bologna, of central Italy, well, it's a kind of element that makes some sense. So there is a kind of a specific culture exceptionality tied to Italian cities. And then probably, and then also some cultural explanation dealing with the Mediterranean. Again, so I'm not quoting here about the Benjamin and all the tradition of the porous and formal city, but still, there is somehow the debate still ongoing whether in the Mediterranean it appeared a specific form of urban gathering that we call Mediterranean city that has so many specificities, a and so many continuities among the circle of interregnum cities that it makes somehow different towards other models of urban systems, which is also somehow fairly true, but still I'm very scientist in that, and I think that comparison is still one of our key tools, and we also have to be careful in comparison, but we don't have to stop our comparative thinking. So I think that there are some things that might be comparable and that gives some interesting elements of reasoning on gentrification. So one thing that is highly comparable, even though we have different elements in that, is the issue of the housing system. It's this typical world in which you can make huge comparison, global comparison, supranational comparison. And what I would like to point here, it's especially the issue of rate of ownership, which is it's a key element that it's going across all the world. It's not an Italian exceptionality, even though Italians started becoming homeowners well before many other Western countries and OECD countries did. But still, there's a growing tendency towards homeownership, even though, and you see this at the international level, the United States, Japan, and Italy, okay, we are bigger than Americans and Japanese in terms of rates of homeownership, but still, we are all above 60%, we are mostly towards 30%. But if you change the scale, and if you go back to the urban scale, then things also change dramatically, which you see huge global cities just like New York and Tokyo, in which the rates of homeownership decrease enormously, and so the rate of tenancy is going all the way around. And Italy, in which, again, Italians are big homeowners, even at the urban level. Rome, it's kind of exceptional. If you go in Milan or Torino, somehow the rate of homeowners at the urban scale is lower than the average national scale, but still it's anyway well above 50%, and generally speaking above 60-65%. So there is something that we have to deal with, it's homeownership, and also the political effects that this enormous amount of homes that households have in their own pocket, on their own basket or whatever, because this has enormous effects in terms of short-term rentals. We will see that later. By the way, it's a tendency that see clear patterns, homogeneous patterns. So forgive me that slides are both in Italian and in English, but still, I think you can get all the information. The green one, it's the homeownership, and the blue one, it's mortgage homeownership. So you have to sum the two and see that there's a growing tendency towards homeownership worldwide. This is OECD, Europe mostly. You have some specific effects of the Eastern countries because of the transformation by law of people on the tendency to homeownership after 1989, but still, the great majority of Europeans are homeowners, with some exceptions, Austrians, Germans, and of course people from Switzerland, which are the less homeowners in Europe. But even though there's a growing tendency to that, and there are different elements in terms of how the market is impacting, because the market, the rental market, is the red one, whereas the black one, it's the public housing rental market. And you see big differences, which in some cases have enormous weight, for instance here in Germany, of the private rental sector for the population. So there are some commonalities, and I think the main commonalities is the rise of homeownership. There's a lot of literature also on the ideology of homeownership, and wonderful books that came the last years on the issue of homeownership. In Italy, it has some specific, so now I'm going back to be contextual. we have an early start of the phenomenon. Of course, this is not a just fluid mechanism. It's fostered by laws and policies. There was a growing policy contract towards homeownership dating back to the end of World War II, in which it was really clearly said that in order to gain stability, political stability, and somehow growth, because of the relationship between the building economy and homeownership, it was relevant that Italians became as fast as possible homeowners. So we have the rate here. This is our census data, 51, that's what decades, 51, 61, and so on and so forth. And this is the constantly growing figures in terms of homeownership. And it started really in the 50s. So I'm asking you here to, it's very sociological, but to move behind those evidence and consider it in terms of generations. So here you have the baby boomers, from here to there, the baby boomers, who became the first one who became massively homeowners. Then we have here Generation X, who are the children of the boom generation, who also became homeowners, but start inheriting house and homes from the previous generation, even though the two generations from the 50s and the 80s were still living together. And then here we have the millennials, again becoming homeowners, and then the rates of inheritance is growing generation after generation. So it's a curve that is increasing also because you have this inheritance effect, which is really important. So we have already three generations of huge homeowners in our country. We have similar figures in other OECD countries, but Italy is really particular because we just started at least one generation before. And if you are, if you know this literature or the debate on this literature, it's interesting because it's like we were neoliberal before neoliberalism was even invented and founded, because it was clearly one of the pillars of Reagan policies, Thatcher policies, and François Mitterrand policies. So again, consider that neoliberalism, it's not right-wing politics, it's politics all the way around. Because the three, Reagan, Thatcher, and Mitterrand, had the same exact policy, and they used the same exact words. We need a nation of homeowners, because of the nexus of political stability and growth, internal growth. So again, we were neoliberal even before neoliberalism was invented. So yes, great success. If you look at class and housing in Italy, how you get to be a homeowner, that's what I was mentioning earlier, it's really relevant. So for instance, this is the upper class, bourgeoisie, la bourgeoisie, this is the middle class, white collar middle class, this is small urban bourgeoisie, this is a small agricultural bourgeoisie, these are the working, the urban working class, and this is the agricultural working class. The way in which they become homeowners, and it's a cross-class phenomenon, of course. Upper classes are more homeowners than any other classes, but each class in Italy, even working class, are more than 50% homeowners. So it's really a cross-class phenomenon. But the way in which classes become and became homeowners, that's really strikingly irrelevant, because you see here the upper classes, at least quasi 50% of the households that are related to the upper classes became homeowners because of the adding phenomenon of donation and inheritances. So once your elders are dead, and also before they die, they provide you with homes. And so more than less than half of the upper classes are getting their homes just before the passing of a generation, and more than one home often. You see the rates are changing according to the class, but they are still very relevant. Even though the issue of donation is clearly related, which is this one, it's clearly related to upper classes more than other classes. So again, I urge you to, and this is very sociological, sorry for that, but I urge you to have a vision of homeownership also related to social classes. Of course, not any single home is similar to any other one. So of course, those who are in the upper classes have the highest value in terms of square meters, and of course they have bigger houses than other classes. But still, there are enormous differences, but still it's an issue of ownership. And this is telling you something, because the way in which classes have the capacity to get a lot of real estate in specific sites, and I'm here exactly talking about city centers and valuable city centers, it's now making new forms of inequalities. Because upper classes that have the rational idea to buy a lot of estates in central touristic sites in Italy, now they are extracting even more rent from that same city centers than the other classes, who probably either didn't have the chance to get the same houses, or they knew about it. So there was a lack of information in terms of which home would you get. So again, it's not to say that every homeowner is a similar homeowner. There's an enormous difference among homeowners, and this makes a big difference all the way around, especially in terms of inequalities. So now I am skipping to gentrification. I didn't provide you so far of any definition of gentrification, because somehow I feel that I can take it for granted. And on the other hand, it would take us another hour of lesson, because since the 50s to, say, last week, there has been enormous empirical theoretical research in gentrification, so the definition changed dramatically in the last 60 years. So again, what Glass was defining in the end of the 50s is not what we are defining nowadays for gentrification. Using the last definition that I think it's kind of useful, we define nowadays gentrification as the production of the city, it's not the central city, of the city, for more affluent users. So it's the upgrading of the city. So it's not only what has been detected in the 50s, 60s and 70s and even 80s, which was the changing of the city centers. But it's the overall transformation of the city, core, but also suburbs, in terms of affluence and change of the population. And so, of course, it deals with the issue of evictions and displacement. I will try to show you two dynamics that were and are still relevant in Italy in terms of gentrification. One is gentrification by desegregation, or you can also call it by collapse. And the other is gentrification by crisis, which is the most recent gentrification, or you can also call it gentrification by reaction, depending on which political stance you want to adopt to define this gentrification. So I'm talking about collapse here. You don't see anything, but you see some red dots and blue dots. But it is the story, which is a not very told story. So Italians kind of know that, but they don't talk as much about it. But probably Venetians actually did talk about this a lot, because it was very striking what happened in Venice. But this is Rome, for instance, and this is the collapse of the working class in the central core of Rome from 1961 to 2001. So this means that in 61, you had, these are the red dots, you had an over-representation of working classes compared to an under-representation of working classes across the city centers. And then as the city developed, you have a spreading of the colors, so it's a move outwards of the, these classes outwards, and then also you have a diminishing of the color, meaning that the gradient, the segregation is decreasing. So you have 31% of working classes living in central Rome in 61. Of course they were not that happy of what was the city center in 61, because according to the history of Rome, they, many people there were still living under bad conditions, bad housing conditions. They were living in barracks still. They were partly living in destroyed buildings because of the war. So it was not a good and healthy living in central cities, but still, they were part of the central fabric of Rome. Whereas now, in 2001, 2011, it's even worse. You hardly will find any of people of working class living in central Rome. Hardly anyone. This is an interesting element, and this is also a cultural interesting element, because one of the things that tourists and the general vision of Italy that you have since the 19th century to the, up to now, is that Italy is an interesting site to visit, because classes are melted and they kind of produce a special mix, a very popular mix, in which you find the gentle, typical authentic Italians having a meal with other people and sitting outside their homes and chit-chatting and having good times with other people. And this was the typical image that we had since 19th century, and it was partially true until the 60s and 70s, which you had really a lot of mixing, especially in the city centers, so at the core of the cities. But this is not actually the experience you may have in Rome, not even talking about Milan, but even in Venice and many other Italian cities. The collapse, it's an enormous collapse. We have the de-densification of the municipal cities by working class. The working classes clearly disappeared from, this is the 19th century, this is how it grew up and then how they disappeared after 1961. There's a lot of reasons for that, and I will give you some examples. But still, one of the things that we are statistically recovering is that you won't find any more working classes in the core of the Italian cities nowadays, especially in the main big 12 Italian cities. It's too little, but I will send you the presentation, so you will get horrified with the slides, you will get it on your computer. I don't see them as well, even though I can use this. So for instance, if you look at Torino, which is now my hometown, but I am Venetian born, I'm just like Professor Bandolin, so it's a very Venetian talk today for you. But if you consider how many people were living in the historical city centers in 1941, in Torino, 114,000 people, Milan is even bigger, Venice was enormous, Bologna was enormous. And if you see the tendency, so I would like to give you the transition. What happened, for instance, Venice, which is a very well-known phenomenon, started decreasing after World War II, and constantly, and this is all because it's 60,000, and now we are heading towards 50,000, more or less, inhabitants in the city center. And if you see the same transition in Torino, you see how we went back to 40,000 people in the city center. But this is the story of any lucky boys. Italian cities from 1951 to up to now. So it's an enormous story of massive displacement, massive addictions, who didn't show up as displacements. This is interesting because even though, especially in Rome and Milan, and also in Venice, there was a momentum in which there were some political fights for the right for housing, diritto alla casa, in the 70s and 80s. it is true that many of the people that were living here at the core, and there were a lot of people, they were living in bad conditions. So many of them, when they flee city centers, they will flee because of welfare. They had new homes, but where were these new homes? Well, the stories, the same stories worldwide. It was the suburbs. It was a massive public production of housing. In Italy, it was two big programs of housing, in a casa at the beginning and then just funds afterwards. And most of the people, the weaker people, working class and living here in these days, they left for good and they went after, outside the city core. They never came back, actually. This is the percentage that are even more striking. You will get the the slide, you will discover by yourself. So it's a very tragic history of displacements. But on the other hand, the other side of the coin, it's displacement because of welfare. And a society that was also growing and people were better. But we lost contact with working classes in the city core. And we paid for that. So you can judge this phenomenon from the double side of the coin. Because if you ask people back in the 70s, are you happy when you are living in the city centers? They might have answered, well, yes, because it's my hometown, it's where I was born, and so on and so forth. But they might also tell you, well, I'm also happy to live in this city core because it's a horrendous place to live in. So it's a very contradictory processes. But it's what we also call gentrification, which is a typically very contradictory phenomenon. So who left and what's left? Well, it was a time in which social mixing was the thing, but nobody cared about social mixing. It was just urban life. It was Italian, typical urban life. We had a lot of popular cultures, local cultures, and this was one of the moments, even in the 19th century, in which we built what was considered Italian culture. And what is now sold as Italian culture. This also it's a story of popular culture and industrial culture, but if you trace the trajectories of the Italian vanguards that make the design, fashion, architecture a success in Italy, and if you look at the history of Milan, they were all living in one neighborhood, more or less, which was Brera. But Brera at that time, from the 50s to 70s, was one of the worst neighborhoods which you would expect to live in Milan. And if you look at the biographies of Bianciardi in terms of literature, of Gio Pomodoro, of Emilio Tadini, of all these enormous, wonderful sozzas, of this generation of highly creative intellectuals, they were living at the city center, but they were living in really poverty conditions. But they were mixed. And this was when Italy was really creative. And we are still drawing on this huge momentum of creativity in Italy. It was very authentic, but it's interesting, nobody cared about authenticity at that time. They were just doing things, they were just inventing things. So the issue of right to the city has been in Italy a long-standing practice. It was just the way it was. We didn't even have to talk about it until the 70s and 80s. And so the nexus between housing conditions, addictions, it's very tricky. Because if we were to defend that time, which was what Cervellati tried to do in Bologna, it was really a specific moment in time in history that didn't last for a long time. So I'm also very critical about what happened afterwards with these experiments. They were really progressive and bright experiments, but the results weren't that successful, at least to me. So what happened more recently? Because it's a very different phenomenon we're having nowadays. Well, somehow we have global elements which are not making any difference from most of the OECD countries. enormous rise of unemployment after 2006 and 2007. Again, a massive rise of unemployment across the younger generation, which makes a very conflictive position across generation, with the youngest accusing the elders of occupying the working markets and not providing any chances for them. And also a huge history of income loss. This started even before the crisis for Italian. If you see the curve of the purchase power of the Italian economy, the crisis started with the passing to the euro system. Even before the crisis of 1993 and 4 was a massive crisis of income. So we are living in, after say 30 years of progressively decrease of income across classes. And then 2008 came, and somehow it was softened in Italy, so we didn't felt the crisis was here until 2012, 2013, because of the fact of homeownership. So if you went back to the United States, or even Spain, or even UK in 2007 and 2008, they faced the crisis directly, immediately, because it was a housing crisis. And because of the fact that most of the people were under tenure and homeownership didn't work as a welfare provision. In Italy, since most of the Italians were living in homes in, that they owned, it didn't feel the crisis was as relevant in terms of housing crisis, but it was massively an income crisis. So loss of jobs, loss of purchasing power. And this is why short-term rentals became crucial. They became crucial worldwide. It's not even an Italian thing, but it was worldwide. Because they were born in 2008, and they became relevant afterwards. Because, of course, they promoted and sustained homeownership as rent extraction. So people have to rely on the main asset they had in time of crisis. And the asset, the household asset, was home, was real estate. I told you, many Italian households were packed with homes. We have 25% of Italian households who are owner that are more than one apartment. 25%, it's very significant. You say, okay, this 75%, we just have one. But 25% is enormous, because there in this 25%, you have people with three, four, five, six flats. So that's very significant. And if you look at the geography, most of them live in cities, of course. So somehow, platform economy sustained homeownership. Because people say, okay, where can I get money, by the way? This kind of housing system. So if I buy new homes, probably it's going to pay me back more than investing in other financial products, which is what happened for many Italian households. So financialization also helped this system. So you know, you see it's an increase of homeownership and a financialized homeownership. But housing systems are equilibrium. And you can consider equilibrium making 100%. If you have 75% people living in the homes they own, you have just 25% of people doing something else. In this 25%, you have to see where are the other quarters going. But that's the market who is lack, who has been lived for other inhabitants. Consider migrants, consider new households, so young, consider people under threat of evictions. And they all have to rely on private rental sector, because in Italy, the public housing sector is providing shelter to 2% of Italian households. So it's very, very, very limited. So if it's only 2% and 75%, 80% the ownership, then the rest is the private market. If in this sector you have short-term rentals getting in, there's a squeezing of the possible housing for the rest of the population. So the rented quota for long-term residents, it's diminishing. But it's also diminishing according to urban geographies, because it's not diminishing. You can imagine that in the outskirts of the city, which nobody wants to live, or few people wants to live, but it's diminishing. Oh, sorry, and the last one. It's diminishing here, of course. So this is the RDNA data mining system used by Airbnb to provide some data around their clusters. And it's a well-known screenshot, so I don't tell you that much on that, but you see how the clusters go across the city center. This is Torino. And if you zoom in the city center, you see that, and most of you don't know Torino, but this is the place, this is the city center, this is where all cultural institutions are, this is where all museums are, all venues are, this is where all tourists want to go. And it's perfectly rational, because the average stay of tourists in Torino, likewise in the other Italian cities, is two point something nights. And if you have just 2 nights to spend in town, you won't like to be outside of the city, you won't be at the core, because there are the institutions and all the facilities. So that's why you have all these dots. And then you have red dots and blue dots. And blue dots is the sharing economy. Red dots is the market. These are the red dots, these are the blue dots. This is the sharing economy because these are the rooms. So this is the only part which is really sharing. So you are a homeowner, you're not leaving your house, you're living there, you're staying put, but you have an extra room and you rent it out. That's sharing to me. And this is the effect of sharing. Few apartments in town. And this is what the ideology of sharing is, but this is the reality. This is our entire apartments that are rented out. And so this is the quota that is given away to tourists and not provided to long-term residents. They might be students, they might be tourists from several generations, but these two populations, students and long-time residents, are the ones who are paying most of the costs of this kind of economy. So it's really a well-common, well-known geography. Well, this is Rome, and Rome is even more violent, of course, than Torino, because Rome is a touristic city, whereas Torino is willing to be, but it's not yet one of it. So you see how clustering is just collapsing to the city center. Here I'm using some slides that my colleagues at the University of Roma Sapienza, this is Filippo Celati, that's our geographer, provided to me. And here you see how the impact in terms of percentage of apartments that are rented out, of all the stock housing that's in some part of the city. So of course Villa Panfili, it doesn't have any interest because it's there are few homes there, and 80% of them it's on Airbnb, but it's accounting for very few housing. But then this is the archaeological site, so 40% of all housing that are there are under Airbnb. This is the city center, historical city center. It's 22.2% of all housing stock under Airbnb. This is Trastevere neighborhood, 19%, and so on and so forth. You see how big the stock of the city has been given to short-term rentals. And here you see the gradient. So it's very concentrated in the city centers. If I go there, these are my friends of Lades Siena, geographers who made a terrific, wonderful report on Airbnb in Italy two years ago, who went in the media, and was the BBC used it. It's a really interesting phenomenon. And they talk about the airification of cities, so they are the people at the Lades Siena. And this is the overall stock. You see the changes from this is where's the sorry, 2015-2016. So in just 1 year, The phenomenon started in Italy from 2012-13. It was visible statistically, but before it wasn't that visible. So the blue ones, this is Florence, just 11% of the overall stock 2015, quasi 80% the year afterwards. This is Venice, this is Rome, this is Verona, Siena, Milan, Naples, Torino, Bologna, and so on and so forth. So I'm glad that you're going to visit Florence tomorrow, because this is where one of the places with the impact of this economy has been wider and more violent. So this is the variation, and the variation is telling something, because Naples, which you wouldn't imagine being one of the more strikingly touched cities by Airbnb, has the greatest growth of listings from 2015-2016. So this is in terms of percentage, Napoli grew up very much, Torino as well, Bologna as well, and so on. So forth, so you will get this information. So it's a really interesting phenomenon. And if you see where all these apartments are located, so the Airbnb scale of it, well, of course they are all in old town, because that's where the money is, that's where tourism is, that's where Uffizi are, and you want to stay nearby Uffizi. I'm not saying that tourists are doing bad, I mean, they're just very strategic. And I would do the same, actually. I do the same when I visit Lisbon, I visit Barcelona, I visit Paris. We all do the same thing. So again, not to accuse tourism as if we were a tourist as well. We are resident, but we are also tourists. Milano has a different story to tell, anyway, because it has a different economy, enormous impact of this sharing economy, but it's more flat distribution of these rentals. Whereas in Rome, you have the peaks in the city center who are even more violent than Florence. So again, geographies account for a lot of the explanation of the phenomenon. So this is what is offered, this is what is demanded to the platform, and this is Florence. So this is what is offered, so what people are listing. 63% within the historic center, 17% of the entire stock. So when you will visit tomorrow the city center of Florence, because you will be at the center, you're not going to the outskirts, I guess, most of the apartments that are there are under Airbnb. And this is the demand. People want to stay even more than that, the city center. So this is why there's a good rational connection. This is really demand and offer that they find themselves. This is a typical neoclassic economics, because people want to stay in city center, and you just offer them what people want, even though the urban effects might be destroying for the quality of the heritage system, both material and social. And in Milano, it's much more blurred again, because you have an offer that you see, it's not completely concentrated in city center, it's much wider than Florence. The demand goes to the city center, but it's more flat. It's not saying that Milano is more, it's more an equal city than Florence, but to the extent that we are mentioning Airbnb, it's fairer than Florence. And Rome is absolutely not that fair, as you can imagine. So, in the background of it, what happened? Well, what happened is somehow it's Italian, somehow it's global. We have the structural shape of the city that changed dramatically. The reason why the working classes collapsed in the city center, it's a double reason. There was a geographical displacement of people, but there were also the end of a world of production in Italy that started even in the 60s and kept dying until nowadays. It is the industrial world, and we kept on losing jobs in that sector, especially in main industrial cities, and we went toward tertiarization and tourism. And tourism seen as nowadays the unique, the sole possible economy for the cities. And the reasons were already been set by my previous colleagues, so I won't go into that, but you know all of them. Then also we have an enormous shift in the social structure, labor markets changing, generation, cultures, as I told you before, and a huge clash in terms of generation and how they use the city, what they are demanding to the cities, which is a great transformation. And then the nexus between income, disposable income, extraction and rent, which is a property nexus. And as some colleagues, US colleagues, especially Peter Marcuse, said, we pass from a home condition to a real estate condition. And again, this is not only, we are not talking to anybody else outside of this room, we're talking about ourselves. We tend to think about us as homeowners or possible potential homeowners, because this gives us also income. So we are financializing our own assets in a very different way than the previous generation. And possibly this is also squeezing middle classes, or anyway giving some troubles to middle classes, and that's why there's a growing literature on middle class squeezing throughout OECD, because middle classes were considered exactly the infrastructure between upper and working classes, and those who were giving stability to the system. They were actually built for that. It was a social contract that created the middle classes. Whereas nowadays, middle classes are probably in trouble because that contract, which was a contract of growth, of income, and also of property, but it was a part of the contract, it was really an income contract, has been completely abandoned. So now I will go to the end of my lecture by showing some interesting quote of a colleague that changed dramatically his mind on this topic. And I'm not telling you who is this colleague, I will see whether you recognize him. So he says, in little more than a decade, the revitalization of our cities and our urban areas that I had predicted was giving rise to a rampant gentrification and unaffordability, driving deep wedges between affluent newcomers and struggling long-time residents. He says, I enter into a period of rethinking and introspection of personal intellectual transformation, of which this book is the result. So he changed radically his mind. I began to see the Back to the City movement as something that conferred a disproportionate share of its benefits on a small group of places and people. I found myself, he says, confronting the dark side of the urban revival I had once championed and celebrated. As the middle class and its neighborhoods fade, our geography is splintering into small areas of affluence and concentrated advantage, and much larger areas of poverty and concentrated disadvantage. Well, maybe this one you can see, I guess so. The advantage of knowledge workers, professionals, and media and cultural workers who made up the creative class were doing fine. Their wages were not only higher in big, dense, high-tech metros, but they made more than enough to cover the cost of more expensive housing in these places. But the members of the two less advantaged classes, blue-collar workers and service workers, were sinking further behind. They actually ended up worse off in large, expensive cities and metro areas after paying for their housing. Gentrification and inequality are the direct outgrowth of this recolonization of the city by the affluent and the advantaged. Here he's talking about the US and Canada, and we have to be very cautious to import this vision exactly as it is to Italian cities. But still, we have some common elements. But who is this guy? This is the question. You know that?
No, I don't know, but I guess.
Richard from the Florida.
Of course, this is Richard Florida.
Of course.
Who did this huge transformation from his previous, the rise of the creative class, to the new urban crisis, was very getting very dark and bitter. But again, even even Richard Florida recognized that some of his previous ideas were kind of flawed ideas. So we have to wonder how we can conclude on that. And I think there's many elements that I would like to point to conclude. On first element, as an urban sociologist, always keeping in mind that cities are all different, even though they are alike. So the economy is one economy. Capitalism is one capitalism. You have varieties of capitalism, you have varieties of neoliberalism, but still capitalism is the glue in which we are all immersed, so that's the glue we have to deal with, even though glues impact differently in each city. Hierarchies count. Berlin, Paris, New York, and Barcelona are playing a specific championship there. It's not the same championship as other cities. Even Italian touristic cities are in another league, which is not a better or worse league, but that's a different league. So meaning different issues, different problems, different dynamics. And would-be touristic cities, just like Torino, or well, they are playing a completely different league. So gentrification are different, but are the same. So again, I urge you to keep in mind that still gentrification, even though has different shapes. And I think we have to be careful nowadays on spatial, environmental, and heritage determinism. So they have their own rights and rationales, but we also have to be more complex on what urbanism is. What is this complex intertwining of classes, generations, cultures, and also laws, entitlements, and then the urban fabric, and not only working on the urban fabric as it is. We often have simplified visions of how people are, what is a middle class, how many people are within a middle class. It's very complex, there's an enormous of scientific work on that. We have to start to learn from these works. And again, on transformation and on complexity. Complexity and heterogeneity have always been the main drivers and the key element of any single urbanism, from the first settlement to the most recent town in China. And we have to foster complexity and heterogeneity. We don't have to solve complexity. I think it's one of the lessons, one of the lessons that I keep from Jay Jacobs, because other lessons of Jay Jacobs are very not with her, but still, the idea that cities are, you know, urban realms, complex and heterogeneous, we have to keep it in mind. And so we have to provide people and activities, and I'm meaning all kind of people and all kind of activities, the chance to profit from the city, because it's where the money is, it's where the richness is, regardless of which people and activities. So we have to be very open up and not to select. So for instance, selecting creative classes, even Richard Florida now recognized it was completely failure. So are we willing just to open up our cities to get into creative classes? They are part of the city, but we just want them. I'm very cautious about it. And also activities. We don't have to rely on a single economy. If we just rely on tourism, well, we saw that what happened in Venice, and we saw that in Florence. It's killing the city completely. So we don't have to rely, never rely on a single economic activity. So we have to discuss whether this is the city we want to live in. Homogeneity is rising. We are patrimonializing homogeneity, whereas we have to go back to our own urban roots, which was really heterogeneous, completely diverse, and we have to stick to this again more and more. Thank you.